Hi, everyone, and welcome. I'm Liam, and today I'm joined by Naomi and Alex from Azure AI Foundry. Thank you for joining. I understand, Naomi, that you're going to be talking a little bit about GPT-5. Can you give me a little bit of the highlight of that model?
Yeah, absolutely, Liam. I'd love to. So GPT-5 is the latest addition to the Azure OpenAI family. It's the first model suite that really unifies chat and reasoning capabilities and intelligently routed by our model router to optimize performance and save cost. It's really designed for real-world, high-stakes workloads, whether that's advanced coding, it might be deep analytics, decision-making, or powering enterprise copilots.
That makes a lot of sense. But are there any areas where you found that it particularly stands out?
Yeah, there's really three big things I would mention. Mm-hmm. First off is that frontier reasoning capability. Mm-hmm. GPT-5 really excels at that multi-step logic and contextual problem solving. It can reason over large complex inputs. Think about thousands of lines of code or hundreds of pages of documents without losing that context. It has also high performance generation. It's not just about thinking, it's about delivering usable and production-ready output code that runs, analyzes, and stands up to scrutiny and language that matches your brand tone. Lastly, I'll mention cost-efficient scaling. So thinking about the Azure AI Foundry model router, we can think about customers can automatically get that right GPT-5 variant for their task. Whether that's GPT-5 reasoning for deep analysis, they might use GPT-5 mini for faster turnaround, right, or GPT-5 nano for lightweight calls.
Well, that's obviously very compelling, but Alex, let's be real. People can get GPT-5 at places outside of Azure. Why should organizations be looking at Azure AI Foundry for this model?
Absolutely, Liam. So enterprises choose Azure AI Foundry for the trusted security and compliance, mm-hmm. also for the seamless integration they get across the entire Microsoft stack, and of course also the governance tools that they can use to deploy GPT-5 responsibly. And lastly, as Naomi mentioned, with the model router, customers get the best balance of cost and performance.
That makes sense. Having the trust and security in their models is so important to all of the organizations we work with. Now, Naomi, you mentioned advanced frontier reasoning. I wonder if you can tell me a little bit more about that, and maybe do you have anything you could show us?
I'd love to. Of course, I'd love to show off how GPT-5 can assist researchers, so especially in peer-reviewing academic work. So first off, we're going to start off by prompting GPT-5 to act as a critical peer reviewer. So mm-hmm. here's the prompt that we're using. Nice. So first off, act as a critical peer reviewer, identify any logical flaws, suggest extensions, flag any verbosity, and then provide 20 concrete extensions. And you can see this sets GPT-5 up to deliver structured and actionable feedback that is both practical and thorough.
And what kind of feedback does GPT-5 actually generate?
So you can see here, like, it's returning a list of suggestions, each with a clear header and a concise summary. So let's look at some of them. Mm-hmm. For example, this paper here doesn't explain how agents are chosen. So GPT-5 is suggesting how to add selection heuristics. It also recommends elaborating on success metrics in this case to improve clarity and reproducibility. And then GPT-5 is also flagging that there's a lack of discussion on performance under large-scale scenarios.
Wow, so we're basically getting technical critique here from GPT-5. I wonder, does GPT-5 go beyond this? Like, for example, can we adjust the writing style, say?
Yeah, exactly. So this is a great question. So it flags that verbose or overly technical language, and it's just suggesting simpler alternatives mm-hmm. for the mere humans among us. So you can see here, in seconds, GPT-5 has delivered 20 targeted suggestions, from those structural improvements to the future research directions. So with that, of course, Alex, do we still need humans to review our papers?
Of course. So while GPT-5 is a powerful assistant, human peer review remains absolutely essential. So academic research is going to demand critical thinking, domain expertise, and perhaps most importantly, ethical judgment. And this is only something that humans can provide.
Exactly.
Yeah. I can see this advanced frontier reasoning being so applicable to so many different organizations, not just in research. It's really great. Now, Alex, we've seen how this can help researchers, but mm-hmm. I wonder, can you tell us a little bit more about how this can help developers, perhaps, to build more advanced applications? I heard you might have a cool little demo. Is that something you could show us?
Absolutely. So, Liam, I'm actually using GPT-5 integrated directly into VS Code using GitHub Copilot to generate code for a website where students can enter different words like nouns, verbs, adjectives. And the app is going to generate both a short story and a matching image. So what I'm trying to do is create a fun way to combine natural language with creativity.
That sounds great. So how does GPT-5 handle that?
Yeah, so what we do is we start with a single prompt. Here's mm-hmm. the prompt. And the prompt has everything GPT-5 needs to create the complete application. So in real-world environments, people will typically start with a simple prompt, and they're going to use GPT-5 to iterate over that prompt and make improvements.
That makes sense, because what you're showing here is quite an extensive prompt, which is great, but I can imagine most people are starting small, a couple of sentences just to get the idea and start iterating. Absolutely. Is that the right way of thinking about this?
Absolutely, Liam. So what we have found is that GPT-5 does quite well at following instructions.
Mm-hmm.
So as you can see in this prompt, the more details you give, the better in helping you create exactly the application that you want.
This is great. So can you show me a little bit more about what it looks like once it actually builds the application?
Absolutely. So let's take a look here at the code. So GPT-5 is going to instantly produce a complete HTML page. We see the embedded JavaScript. It's going to handle the form inputs, dynamically build a story using the words, and then also call an image generation API, like Azure OpenAI Image 1, to visualize the user inputs.
Wait a minute. We're using GPT-5 to create an application that's going to use GPT-5 as well as Image Gen. That's pretty cool. I like that.
Absolutely. And it's all available in Azure AI Foundry. Let's take a look, Liam, here at the website of what's generated by this code. Mm-hmm. So as you can see here, the user, the student, can enter in the various words, and they can also see the story and the corresponding image.
Wow, that's amazing, just from a single prompt. Now, Naomi, like, this is cool and amazing in the education space, but I could actually imagine this might be applicable in other areas. Is that right?
Yeah, that's exactly right. So you've seen here, of course, with education, but we could use this in all kinds of enterprises and industry use cases. And so being able to use perhaps brand imagery, maybe you're recreating, you know, different portfolios, or maybe you've got product imagery that you want to do as part of this too. This is a great way to be able to use all of that power of GPT-5.
Amazing. That's a great example of how GPT-5 makes coding more intuitive through natural language. Mm-hmm. But coding is just one side of the story. Naomi, I understand through GPT-5, there's something called tool calling as well as freeform tool calling. Can you tell me a little bit more about what that means and why that's so important?
Yeah, I'd love to share that with you, Liam, and most importantly, to show you it. So First off, let's look at one of the most developer-centric features that we have in GPT-5. Mm-hmm. So instead of rigid JSON, GPT-5 can actually call tools with natural text, mm-hmm. like raw Python scripts or SQL queries or configs. And that means faster integration and more intuitive workflows.
So unlike traditional tool calling that leverages JSON, the freeform makes it more natural language that allows us to really extend mm-hmm. the types of tools, such as calling Python code or SQL, as you mentioned. Is mm-hmm. that right?
That's exactly right. Great. So no wrapper, and there is no friction. So let's check it out. Cool. So let's imagine that we are inventory specialists at a national retailer. One of our daily tasks is to generate those weekly revenue summaries. Mm-hmm. So normally this means I got to write SQL code, I got to run it, I got to export the data, and then I've got to format it with Python. So it's time consuming and it requires a lot of different handoffs. So with GPT-5's preform tool calling, we can really make this an easy way to automate that entire workflow. So the model is going to generate that SQL, it's going to call a tool to execute it, and then it's going to call another tool to format the results, and it's doing it all in one loop. No JSON, no switching tools, just natural language.
Nice.
So label defining two tools here. So SQL execute light basically helps us here. So we're going to define two tools. SQL SQL light runs that SQL and returns results in CSV. Code exec Python is going to run our Python and return our output. So I'm going to ask GPT-5 here to generate that SQL to create a sales table and that compute revenue. And then I'm going to ask it to go run a conversation loop. We're going to use that loop to basically send the prompt to GPT-5, detect that there's a tool call, execute the tool, and then send that output back to GPT-5 and continue until it's done. So as you can see here, GPT-5 has returned a neatly formatted summary of all of those product revenues that we need, all via orchestrated tool chains.
Well, that's amazing. So not only did GPT-5 figure out which tools it needed to mm-hmm. use, but it created all of the natural language text to actually call those tools and execute it on its behalf. That's really amazing. I can imagine how this could open it up for all kinds of different types of tools within applications.
Exactly.
That's pretty great.
Exactly. So there's really three big ones that we can look at. So there's no JSON that's been required. Mm-hmm. You can see that's natural output. And then there's multi-tool orchestration. All of this makes it a very developer-centric tool. So we've simplified scripting, we've sped up all of that reporting, and we've enabled richer and more intuitive interactions into the data. GPT-5 maintains context across all of these steps, so it can chain those tool calls intelligently, and it makes it perfect for dynamic automation and multi-tool orchestration.
This is really a game changer for developers in any industry.
Exactly. It's absolutely true. I mean, this is going to be applicable to so many different organizations and developers. Naomi and Alex, amazing demos. Before we wrap up, what should AI practitioners and developers take away from today?
Yeah, so GPT-5 is so much more than just a model. It is a toolkit for reasoning, for generation, and orchestration.
And Alex, how can people get started?
So the best way is to start small. Pick one high-impact use case, and then try GPT-5 on Azure AI Foundry.
Mm-hmm. Naomi and Alex, thank you for walking us through this. And thanks to all of you for watching.
And go start building with GPT-5 now!